Semicircular canals is a part of a vestibular system that conveys the information about the head motion with respect to the gravity to the brain. In this video, I am going to tell you the structure of the semicircular canal and the function of the semicircular canal in this vestibular system. Welcome back to HM Learnings. I am Harshita, the creator of HM Learnings, where students come to clear their concept and to get the study material. Make sure that you have subscribed my channel. You can also follow HM Learnings on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter. And now we are going to start our today's video, that is about the semicircular canals, which is a part of a vestibular system. So in the part 1, if you remember, we have discussed about the otolith organ, that is the utricle and the saccule. And in this video, we are going to discuss about the structure of the semicircular canal and the function of the semicircular canal and how exactly the brain comes to know that the head is moving by the help of the semicircular canal. So firstly, the structure. So the semicircular canal is actually a semicircular tube of the membranous epithelium, which is extending from the vestibule. It has actually two ends. One is open to the vestibule and the other end is open, is actually called as an ampulla. So entire lumen of the ampulla is transposed by a gelatinous diaphragm, which is called as a cupula, and the stereocilia and the gynocelium, which are actually extending from the hair cells, are actually embedded in this cupula, and the hair cells are actually present in the neuroepithelium, which is called as a crystra. So these lines can be cleared by the help of this diagram. So in this diagram, you can see that this is the cochlea and this is actually the peripheral vestibular apparatus, which has the utricle and the saccule, and as well as the three semicircular canals, which are the horizontal, anterior and the posterior. So you can see the two ends are being there of each semicircular canal. The one end is arising from the vestibule and the other end is actually enlarged, which is called as an ampulla. Now this is showing the enlarged, or you can say the magnification of the ampulla. So in the ampulla, you can see that what is happening, this is filled with the endolymph. This blue is actually the endolymph, and this is the neuroepithelium in which the hair cells are present. Now the hair bundle, or the stereocilia and the tallest stereocilia, which is called as a gynocelium, is actually extending from this neuroepithelium and embedded in a gelatinous diaphragm, which is this called as a cupula. So what is happening that when there is a motion, what is happening, the relative motion between the endolymph and the cupula causes the bending of the cupula, which is actually transferred the mechanical energy to the hair bundles, to the stereocilia. There will be bending of the stereocilia. With the bending of the cupula, there will be opening of the channels, and hence there is change in the membrane potential of the hair cells. So that we are going to see in the upcoming slides of how it is happening. So I hope that these points are clear. Apart from this, the difference between the utricle and the from the otolith organs in the semicircular canal is then that in the utricle and the saccule, we have seen the concept of the morphological polarization, which says that the orientation of the gynocelium is actually different. So, but here what is happening, in one semicircular canal, all the gynocelium are actually pointing in a single direction, in the one direction only. And that is why the semicircular canals, they are responsive to the motion of the head in one plane. So each semicircular canal is more responsive to the motion of the head in a one particular plane, and the other another one is in the another plane. So that is what, that is because of this concept that the hair cells, the gynocelium, are actually pointing in the one direction in the semicircular canal. So there are three pairs of semicircular canal, and these, the naming of this semicircular canal is actually based on the plane, based on the fact that in which plane they are responding maximally. So anterior semicircular canal is actually responding to the motion of the head in the anterior plane. Posterior one is in the posterior plane, and horizontal one is a motion of the head when it is happening in the horizontal plane. And all these canals are actually lying 90 degrees to each other. So this point I have actually explained to you. Now what is happening, that we know that we have three semicircular canals on the left side and we have a three semicircular canals on the right side. Now they are acting in a form of a three pairs, which is called as a coplanar planes. So what is happening that the right horizontal canal is acting together with the left horizontal canal to predict the direction and the magnitude of the head movement, and this is what is called as a coplanar planes. So what is happening that the hair cells which has a similar orientation in the left semicircular canals, the kinocelium, if suppose the kinocelium in the left semicircular canal is pointing towards the right, all the semicircular canals are towards the right in the right left semicircular canal, the hair cell polarization will be completely opposite in the right semicircular canal. That means there the hair cells will be pointing in a left direction. So this point will become more clear when we talk in the upcoming slides. So this is a diagram which is showing you the concept of the coplanar planes. So this is a left horizontal canal of the right side. So the right horizontal canal and the left horizontal canal, these both are acting in a coplanar pair. So what is happening if there is increase in the firing in the one side semicircular canal, there will be decrease in the firing of the opposite side horizontal canal. So similarly, the right side anterior semicircular canal is acting along with the left side posterior canal because they are in the same plane. Similarly, the anterior one of the left side is acting along with the posterior one of the right side, and this is what is a concept of the coplanar planes, which I hope will become more clear when we talk about further in the upcoming slides. Okay, so the function of the semicircular canal is actually to detect the angular acceleration where the head turns and the rotates. So the point we need to understand here is that it is not detecting the angular velocity, it is detecting the angular acceleration. So when the person starts moving the head, what is happening? That there is a change in the velocity of the head movement, there is some angular velocity with which the head is moving. At that time, we come to know that the head is moving because of the semicircular canals. Now, if the person moves the head with the constant velocity, with the constant angular velocity, what happens to the semicircular canals now? Stops firing. But if the person is moving the head with the change in the angular velocity, that is with the angular acceleration, which could be increase in the angular velocity or which could be decrease in the angular velocity, but the thing is that the angular velocity is changing, so you are applying angular acceleration. So angular acceleration will be detected by the semicircular canal but not the constant angular velocity. So this is a point which is important, and this point is there because of the cupula elasticity and the viscosity of the interlip, which I'll clear further. So now we can take an example of what happens when you're moving the head towards the left side. So we know that in the horizontal plane, you are moving the head in the left side in the horizontal plane. So in the horizontal plane, we know that which semicircular canal has the maximum response. It is a horizontal canal. So both the horizontal canal, the left and the right, they are actually going to respond to a motion of the head in the left side because these are the coplanar players. So what is a coplanar pairs? So what is happening in the left semicircular canal and in the right semicircular canal when the person starts moving the head in the left direction? So what happens is that the membrane's labyrinth starts moving in the left direction, but because of the inertia of the endolymph is not started moving it. This could be understood by taking an example of a cup of a coffee. So you have started moving the cup, you are rotating the cup, but the coffee initially doesn't start moving because coffee has inertia. But as you move your hand, what happens? The coffee also starts moving. So similarly, it is happening here that the membrane's labyrinth, the cup of the coffee starts moving, but because of the inertia of the endolymph, the endolymph is not moving. And because the endolymph is not moving, it is going to cause a bending of the cupula in the direction opposite to the head movement. So this can be understood by the help of the diagram here. So what is happening that you have applied a head motion in one direction, suppose you have applied in the left direction, what is happening that the endolymph has an inertia, endolymph is not moving, which is going to cause a bending of the hair cells in the opposite direction, bending of the cupula in the opposite direction. Now this bending of the cupula will cause a bending of the hair cells, and depending upon that which semicircular canal it is, if it is a left semicircular canal and you are moving the head in the left direction, there will be bending of the stereocilia towards the chymocelium, which is going to cause the depolarization because of the increase in the potassium conductance. So there will be change in the firing rate of the FNF fibers, which cause the change in the firing rate of the left vestibular nuclei. Now what is happening to the right semicircular canal when the head is moving towards the left direction? So here also the membranous labyrinth starts moving, but because of the inertia of the endolymph, it's not moving and it is going to push the cupula in the direction of the head motion. So the arrangement of these semicircular canals, which are acting as a coplanar pairs, is in such a way that if the motion is happening in a one direction, this is going to cause an increase in the firing in the one semicircular canal, and this is going to cause the same motion, the same direction motion is going to cause a deep hyperpolarization in the opposite coplanar semicircular canal. So this is going to cause a bending of the stereocilia away from the chymocelium, which is going to cause a hyperpolarization, change in the firing rate, and change in the firing rate of the right vestibular nuclei. Now the left and the right vestibular nuclei in the brainstem, they are connecting to each other and they are actually analyzing that what is happening, what is the level or the percentage of the change, the degree of the change in the firing rate, the signal which is coming from the left, the signal which is coming from the right. And by this is they are going to interpret that this could be the direction of the moment and this could be the magnitude of the moment. So now by this, the signals which are arising from the both of the sides, from both of the ears, from both of the semicircular canals, by the concept of the coplanar pairs, the brain comes to know that the head is actually moving towards the left direction. It is having an angular motion in the left, and what is the magnitude also. So I hope that you are now clear with the coplanar planes. So this is called as a bidirectional response, which is being there in the each semicircular canal, which is actually cause a firing rate, increase in the firing rate when the stimulus is in their direction. So if the stimulus is actually in the left direction, so this is going to cause an increase in the firing of the left semicircular canal, but decrease in the firing of the right semicircular canal. And if the motion is in the right direction, this is going to cause a decrease in the firing of the left semicircular canal and increase in the firing of the right semicircular canal. And by this comparison of the firing rates of the two sides, there will be reduction of the direction of the movement and the magnitude of the head movement. Now what happens when the head stops moving? So when the head stops moving, now you have stopped the cup from moving. What happens is the coffee continues to move for some time because of the inertia of the coffee. So here also the labyrinth stops moving, but the endolymph is still moving in both of the canals. And now here the opposite is going to happen, that here there will be hyperpolarization and here there will be the depolarization. And now this is going to be again conveyed to the left vestibular nuclei and the right vestibular nuclei. And their comparison is going to predict that this is going to be the conclusion that now the head stops moving. And we have to remember that always there is a spontaneous firing when there is no stimulus. At that time also there is some degree of the spontaneous firing from the left and the right semicircular canal, which is actually equal, which actually says that your head is not moving, your head is still. So what happens now, the firing rate comes to that level that the firing rate in the left and the right both are going to be equate each other to know that the head is not moving now. Okay, so with this we are at the end of this video. If you like this video, please like, share and comment. Please subscribe to HM Learnings, and till then, keep learning.